brings us to the next speaker, of course, Allon Raiz. He's the founder of and CEO of Raizcorp, the only privately held, unfunded, profitable business incubator in Africa, supporting in excess of 240 businesses. You're probably working with him. If you're not, you will probably be working with him very soon. Best-selling author as well of Lose the Business Plan. That's one of his books. And What to Do. I hope you're not going to be reading this one just yet. What to Do When You Want to Give Up. He has also hosted a radio show in Britain and hosted a primetime reality TV show, both in the field of entrepreneurship. Allon is a co-founder of Entrepreneurs Organization of South Africa, Rural Roots. He's also got international recognition as well. 2008, awarded as a Young Global Forum by the WEF, the World Economic Forum. And he was invited in Davos at one of their meetings last year to be one of the speakers. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome Allon Raiz now to talk about the eight characteristics of successful entrepreneurs.
Okay, I want to talk. Have you often heard the question, are entrepreneurs born or are they made? Have you heard this question? So how many of you think that entrepreneurs are born? How many of you think they are made? Okay. Well, a piece of research came out of the US about 5-6 years ago, which showed that the most successful echelon of first-time entrepreneurs were indeed 60 years old and over. So hear what I'm saying now. The most successful first-time entrepreneurs started their business at 60 years and over. And what that does to this question is completely make it irrelevant. Because if you saw an entrepreneur, an individual worked for IBM for 30 years at the age of 55, and you took a photograph of them and you said, is this person an entrepreneur? You would say, of course not. This person's been working at IBM for 30 years. And yet 5 years later, they become the most successful echelon of first-time entrepreneurs. Do you see how it messes up that question? Okay. Now, if you go and read, if you come to a university or you come to Raizcorp, we'll tell you, of course, entrepreneurs can be taught. We can teach you how to become an entrepreneur. We'll tell it to you from our perspective. But you ask many entrepreneurs, you'll say, no, they'll say, no, we're born, we're very, very special. We're very special people. The others, you know, can't be like me. So depending who you ask this question to, you get a completely different answer. But this piece of research messes up that question. So I want to put you this morning a different understanding of this question. It's the wrong question. I want to talk about five conditions that I believe need to be present in your life in order for you to precipitate as what I call a trading entrepreneur. Now, many of us have got a business ideas, thinking about starting a business, might even have registered a CC or a PTY, and you know, when we're in at a dinner party, you know, we'll say, yeah, I've got a business. But you and I both know there's no business. You haven't traded yet. So for me, what I'm very interested about is that what happens between that point where you come up with this idea or see the opportunity and actually precipitate into a trading entrepreneur. What makes that happen? Okay. What they call a nascent entrepreneur to a trading entrepreneur. So the first thing that happens in every single story, and all the entrepreneurs in the room, you will attest to these things. The first thing that needs to be present is an opportunity or a crisis. You will never ever start a business without seeing an opportunity or a crisis presenting. You lost your job, you got fired, you got retrenched, somebody died, which forced you into a different set of circumstances. So without a crisis or opportunity, no business will start. Okay. Now, think about the entrepreneurs in the room. That each one of you that started your business either saw that opportunity or crisis presented. Number two, you have to have a tolerance for pain, high tolerance for pain. You will not move from that nascent entrepreneur to a trading entrepreneur if you don't have a tolerance for pain. Because as the MEC said, it's tough to be an entrepreneur, it's tough to be a business person. And as you start your business, you're either going to be too old, too young, too black, too white, too tall, too short. You're always going to be too something for the market. And if you can't take that negative feedback, that pain, the fact that you've done the work and didn't get paid on time, if you cannot handle that pain, you will not move from a trading entrepreneur, from a nascent entrepreneur, through to a trading entrepreneur. Okay. So I talked to your stories as entrepreneurs in the room, the people who started their businesses. The fact that you are still here means that you have some level of tolerance for pain. If you want to understand the psychological drivers underneath that, that's got to do with self-esteem, drive, and a whole bunch of other things. But it really, the nub of it is tolerance for pain. So, I see the opportunity. I've got a tolerance for pain, but do I have the tolerance for risk? Okay. Now, if you look, are there any people in their 20s here? Okay, so let's take you. Yeah? You're in your 20s. How old are you?
I'm
27. 27. Okay. Anyone younger than that? Okay. How old are you?
20.
20. Fantastic. All right. Do you have a car?
No.
You don't have a car. Okay.
She's still in the incubator.
Okay. Is there anyone here who's in their 20, early 20s with a car? You're in the early 20s of the car. Okay, we'll start with you. Okay. I need to find the example. Yeah. All right. So here's what happens now. The opportunity presents. We both have an opportunity. We both have a tolerance for pain. But I'm in my mid-40s. I have two kids in private school. I have a bond. Okay. And I have two cars to pay off. I'm assuming your circumstances are very different to me. So when the opportunity presents to you or her, or it presents to me, my tolerance for risk would be very different to hers. So it has to line up that I'm in a position in my life where my tolerance for risk is equal to the what I perceive to be the opportunity, the risk reward for me. So you will see that often that when you're looking at these 60-year-olds, just think about what's happening with these 60-year-olds, that their kids are out of home, their house is paid for, they've probably moved from a bigger home to a smaller home, they've got some excess cash. And now when the opportunity presents, the tolerance for risk is pretty much close to yours and very different to mine. So you see this bell curve in terms of the amount of opportunity taken up through your life, depending what your risk profile is. And of course, different people have different attitudes to risk. But that's a big player in terms of determining whether or not you actually precipitate from this nascent entrepreneur to a trading entrepreneur. The fourth thing, and the words are chosen very, very carefully, is not your ability to master resources, but your belief in your ability to master resources. Not your ability to master resources, but your belief in your ability to master resources. In other words, if the opportunity presents, and I have the tolerance for risk, and I have the tolerance for pain, do I believe I can put together the people and the resources and the cash, etc., in order to take advantage of this opportunity? And you will see in your life, there are many examples of these people. So the person I like to use is a lady called Joy Malloy from Alex, who saw an opportunity in plumbing. She wasn't a plumber, but she got a whole bunch of plumbers together in order to take advantage of the opportunity. She believed she could put that together. Okay. So do you have a belief in your ability to put the resources together in order to take advantage of the opportunity? And finally, do you have the ability to learn and iterate? What happens when you go out with this business, when you start a business, you're going to get feedback. You're too expensive, you're too this, you're too that, you're too the other thing. So we've spoken about tolerance for pain. But what's very important, what you see with successful entrepreneurs, is that they take that feedback and they iterate their products or services to make sure that they find the market. The ones that fail in the first 3 to 6 months are not iterating or not changing based on the feedback. So you started your shop, your products, what you thought when you started and what you have now, I don't even know, but I can tell you without even knowing you, it's different. You've read what clients have asked for, and if you are to succeed, you will change what you initially thought to what you have now. Those are the five things that need to be present for a company to move from a nascent entrepreneurial space to a trading space. Okay. Now I'm going to talk about the eight characteristics of successful entrepreneurs. So we all have heard about perseverance, that ability to stand up again and again and again and again. If you look at the underlying psychology of perseverance, it's got to do with self-esteem. It's got to do with the fact that I believe I deserve what that thing is in my mind to achieve, and despite what feedback I'm getting from people, I will stand up again and again. There isn't one story, there isn't one successful entrepreneur that hasn't dropped to their knees at some point in order to stand up and move forward. Okay. You hear it, whether it's with Steve Jobs or Bill Gates or any one of our fantastic South African entrepreneurs. Each one in their storyline has moments where they hit that wall. There's almost a sexual turn on from being told you can't do something. Okay. If you can sort of get a little turned on when somebody says it can't be done, or you will not do it, or you will never get there, you're probably going to be one of those successful entrepreneurs. Yeah. Okay. The second thing, very important, is flexibility. If you feed back into my five conditions, you'll see flexibility is an ability to then say, well, I know that was my plan, but that's not actually what the market is telling me, so let me change. Let me be flexible in this plan. So I wrote a book called Lose the Business Plan. Okay. And I strongly believe that the business plan is the absolutely worst determinant of success or failure. If 96% of businesses fail, half of them are financed through friends, fools, family, and financial institutions. Okay. All based on this BS. Can I say BS? Can I say what it is? You started it. You said bitch, so I can say yes. Okay.
Just you.
Just me, thanks. This thing called a business plan. And yet they all look exactly the same. Well, every single business plan looks exactly the same. It's a J. Year one, I need lots of money. Year two, I think I'm going to break even. And year three, I'm going to make so much money that I need an extra, you'll see in the business plan, I've got an extra 5 million rand. What do you need that for? To build 2 warehouses. What do you need the warehouses for? To put all my cash in, because I don't trust the bank with that much money. They look exactly the same. It's a J curve every single time. XYZ company in Calibri font 14, there it is, and they all look exactly the same. Just put your name in, every single business plan looks exactly the same. Yet the reality is 96% of businesses fail. And I can tell you, if you ever bring me a business plan, you know the business plans when they come in and they're still warm from the photostat machine, that photostat machine warmers, where you can feel that they've worked all night on it, and then they come in the morning, they present it to you, and you can feel. And what I do is I take that business plan and I tear it in two in front of you, and I say, while your eyes are wide open, I say, how do you make money? How does this business make money? If you cannot answer that question, I don't care what the business plan says. If it doesn't live in here and here, it cannot live on this document. And I often am asked to speak around this, and it's very interesting, the banks always call me in once to speak. They never call me back again after I say this. But then I ask the banks, now, you tell me, honestly, have you ever seen a business plan that equals reality? Now, well, there were 4 studies done between 1994 and 2004, which show there's absolutely no correlation between a business plan and business success. No correlation. Okay. The one in 2004 shows that if you write a business plan, you're actually less likely to become successful. Now, what I'm saying is not that you should not do the business plan. The title of the book is Lose the Business Plan. Once you've done it, lose it. Because it allows you to think methodically through your competition, your pricing, etc. But here's what I'm talking about. It's your ability to navigate obstacles. It's your ability to navigate those obstacles and find alternative solutions that determine success or failure. It's your ability to see opportunity that wasn't present in your initial thinking and do something about it that determines success or failure. Not this thing called a business plan. Flexibility is the biggest determinant in my mind of your financial success. And you will see amongst entrepreneurial, your successful entrepreneurs, if you ask them how they started and where they ended, it just keeps changing. You have this ability to keep changing, to be flexible. Are you flexible? Number three, they understand their negative psychological drivers. Understand what it is that they're afraid of. Okay. Do you understand what you're afraid of? Do you understand what it is that you don't want to happen? So you've all heard, of course, of Walmart right now. Sam Walton, who was a founder of Walmart, was asked in an interview once by a journalist, Mr. Walton, did you ever want to give up? And he said, of course I wanted to give up. And he said, well, why didn't you give up? And he said, because when I was a little boy, my father worked for a bank, and it was during the Great Depression. And his job was to go and repossess farms and homes from people who couldn't pay their bonds or their mortgages. And he begged his father one day during the school holidays to let him go and see, you know, what he did. And he spoke about the fact that when he went with his father, he watched grown men drop to their knees in front of his father and beg his father not to take away their farm or home that had been in their family for three generations. And he watched the children of these men watching their fathers begging to his father. And he swore to himself that he would never allow that to happen to him. So every time while building Walmart, he wanted to give up, which was many times, he played that movie in his head. So when I'm asking you as entrepreneurs and would-be entrepreneurs, do you understand your negative psychological driver? What is it that you don't want? Okay. Father issues. How many of you got issues with your father? Okay, there's one honest person, two honest people, three honest people, four, five. You're coming out the closet. You're coming out the closet now. Well, I'll tell you that there's two psychologists, Collins and Moore, that showed that if you have a father issue, you're far more likely to become a successful entrepreneur. Far more likely. Okay. And if you have an overdoting mother and an absent father, you're far more likely. That's the perfect combination. Okay. So if your mother's saying, why aren't you married? You know, are you warm enough? Etc. If that's your kind of mother that you have, and you have this absent father, whether he's absent, he's passed away, your parents are divorced, or he's emotionally absent from you, you don't know him, you're far more likely to become successful entrepreneur. And I can spend half an hour explaining that. Okay. So how many of you have father issues now? Okay. And why I tell people this is because for me, a lot of people think that it's actually will take away something from them as an entrepreneur. In fact, the research shows that it's actually one of the biggest drivers. Authentically able to reframe a situation. So this is not every cloud has a silver lining, but this is about being able to see a situation and ask authentically, and this is a very important word, authentically. Okay, what happens if this were a good situation? So no matter how bad it seems, that they reframe their situations constantly. Successful entrepreneurs reframe. Do you reframe? Now, when thinking about what I was going to talk about today, I thought, I'm not going to tell you everything you can read in a book. I'm going to talk about the stuff that I see anecdotally and understand at a different level. You're not going to hear many people talk about characteristics of successful entrepreneurs are acknowledging luck. But I can tell you from working with thousands of entrepreneurs during my career, that the one thing that I see amongst the successful ones is they completely acknowledge how lucky they were in their journey. The unsuccessful ones, the ones that are shooting stars that they then fade out, are the ones that say, it's all me. I'm the clever one. This was all about me. And my mentor, who is a dollar billionaire, will tell you that he was just lucky to be in a certain place at a certain time. He saw the opportunity, he did something about it, and created other opportunities which were lucky. And he moves from one piece of luck to the next. But what I really want to emphasize is that they acknowledge that as part of the equation, okay, in why they're successful. It's a level of humility that allows them to continue to be lucky. And we all know those entrepreneurs out there who are not humble, that are all about the image, which is probably very different to the reality. And we see straight through it. And then there are the other guys who completely acknowledge how lucky they were through that journey. And what you'll find is that people would rather work with people who are humble than people who are arrogant. So acknowledging luck is a very, in my opinion, a very, very important characteristic of a successful long-term entrepreneur. High internal locus of control. So in Raizcorp, we take you through a very strict intake process. On average, 1 out of 20 applicants will get through to if you want to apply to get into Raizcorp. Part of that is we do an internal locus of control test. So we have a scale of 0 to 20. And we will take you only if you are between 12 and 16. If your internal locus of control is below 12 on our scale, for us it means it's an external locus of control. You're waiting for life to happen to you. It's all about fate. If your internal locus of control is too high, you're a 20, then you know everything. You're in complete control. And for us, that means you can't learn. And remember what our fifth point, my fifth condition was the ability to learn and iterate. So when we see somebody coming through with a 20 on the ILC test, we reject them immediately because they cannot learn. And learning is an important part of flexibility and a successful entrepreneurship. So how much do you think in your world as an entrepreneur that you are in control? Are you completely in control? Are you completely in God's hands? Do you have some level of control? Where do you fit on that scale? Extremely resourceful. So, to most people, this will be a glass. To the entrepreneur, this will be many more things than a glass. This will be a vase. This will be something I can draw a circle with. If I break it, it can become a weapon. I can use it for all sorts of things. So when you see an entrepreneur in a situation, they have at their disposal, given the same number of things, they have far more resources than the average person, and they can then put those together in different ways. They see things differently. How resourceful are you? Are you seeing a glass as a glass, or do you see it as it's got five different applications or more? And you see that in the stories of successful entrepreneurs, how their minds work, where they creatively reuse things in different ways that other people don't genuinely see. Okay, so are you genuinely resourceful? And I thought I'd throw in a bonus because it says 8. I'm not sure I think entrepreneurs walk fast. Okay, I really think, and this is a throw, there is absolutely no research around this. This is completely my view. And I'll tell you where I get this from, because I speak around the world, and I spoke in Tanzania a couple of months ago, and there was a massive audience, and it was half government and half entrepreneurs. And I'm still trying to work out the reason, but when it came for lunchtime, the entrepreneurs were the first ones to leave. And they were the first ones back. Okay. Now one can argue they walked faster or they just wanted the free lunch. Okay. But really, there's a sense of urgency. Okay, that entrepreneurs have. Okay. Are there any Americans in the room? Any Americans?
We want to see them.
Okay. Okay, so I'm going to uh, I'm going to now mock the American. I'm going to try and be an American right now. If you're going to be a successful entrepreneur, you're going to have passion, man. You're going to have passion. Bullshit. Let's talk about that now. Let's talk about this thing called passion, because you will read about passion in every book in entrepreneurship. Every book will say you've got to be passionate. So whenever I see an entrepreneur, they say, what do? I'm in IT. What are you passionate about? I'm very passionate about IT. The zeros, the ones, the box, the Ys. What is it about? No, very passionate about IT. Now, I've got a friend who's got a waste disposal company listed on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange. I can't imagine him sitting in front of his mom's in kitchen looking at the rubbish bin going, ooh, I'm passionate about rubbish. Okay. And the problem with this is that every time, I make a joke of it now, but there's a very important message in this, is that you've got to understand what you're truly passionate about and link that to what you do. And too often we don't push through to the next level. We just bullshit ourselves and talk about the fact that I'm passionate about organic stuff. You're not passionate about organic stuff. 5 years ago, you read about it for the first time. I'm not passionate about incubation. I didn't even know what an incubator was when I first started. I'm passionate about something else. And I just want to correct something about what this thing about it's all about the money. Okay, it's not about the money. Because once you get to a point of break even, it's about something else. The thing that pushes you through is not the money. The thing that makes you persevere is about this movie that's playing in your head about what you could be. And you have to link your passion to that movie. Don't fall into the trap of saying, I'm passionate about, and you just fill it in the blank, whatever you do. So, what does the ultimate entrepreneur look like? My last slide. Very thick shoes. On average, 5.2 years to become a successful entrepreneur. That's the international stat. Knee pads and elbow pads, because you're going to be falling a lot. Okay. Also, very, very good for begging to your bank manager. Yeah. I refer to the groin area there. Okay. Oh, gosh. Disappeared. There. Okay. You've got to have big ones. Okay. And ladies, you've got to have big ones too. This is a tough, tough, tough journey. Tough, tough journey. And if you don't have that courage, you don't have that perseverance, you're going to be one of those 96% of businesses that fail. You have to have a very thick belt, okay, that you can tighten your belt. And there's wonderful research that shows that if you start without money, you're far more likely to succeed than if you start with money. Because your values are set differently. Okay. Because when you walk past that photostat machine and there's a piece of paper on the floor, if you started without money, you'll pick it up. If you started with money, it's not worth it. It's just a piece of paper. Your value sets in terms of your long-term success are determined very early on in your entrepreneurial career. And finally, you have to have very thick glasses to see what it is that you want to achieve. To see that vision, to see that movie. And constantly, every time you fall, to stand up again and see that movie every single time. So, ladies and gentlemen, those of you who are wanting to become successful entrepreneurs, who might be thinking about it, and you feel you don't have it, rather don't start. Your statistics will show that if you don't have the right set of characteristics, you're not going to succeed. And for those of you who are in this journey, you're thinking about giving up because it's so damn tough. If you feel you have these characteristics, I encourage you to persist and push through, because South Africa needs you. Thank you.
Thank you, Allon. Thank you.